All right, welcome to our special. We're now coming into these extraordinary times. I'm taping this on a actual inauguration day, which is Sunday. Because it falls on a Sunday this year, it's being moved to a Monday, but technically today is inauguration day. And so we're using this day to inaugurate the global challenge. And if someone wants me to lend my name to it, I can do that. But if someone wants to say, well, Clarity Ross's global challenge, I say, well, okay, why not? Why? Because I do know the answer to the question. Conceptually, it's very clear. And I know there's a knowing that this is it. This is right. So very, very clear about it now. And just in time, just in the nick of time, of course. It's always the way, isn't it? Cutting it close. I mean, today is the day, and here we are with the answer. And I was able to see this morning just what the difficulty it really is. What does it boil down to? I'm able to explain it, able to clarify it, but words are not magical. Words are not some magical pill you take and you get it. Words simply are pointing to an inner clarity that everyone has to eventually see it for themselves. So there's not like a way that I can explain it that'll, boom, you get it suddenly. Oh, now I get it. It's not quite like that. Words are helpful, very helpful, but not the greatest help. They have some practicality to them, but not the highest practicality. They're still quite whimsical because they're subject to interpretation. So words are inherently very impractical, very whimsical, but they can be given a different purpose. So they tend to have some, at least some, utility to them. When we're talking about the spiritual path, we're talking about practicality. We're talking about utility. Ultimately, the spiritual path is the most practical way to use your time, without question. And it leads to the solution, which is utterly practical. Totally practical. The real struggle in this world is between what is practical and what is whimsical. Because the world believes that what they're doing is the ultimate practicality, which is really a contingency plan in case reality were to be destroyed. Existence is a hypothetical scenario. It's a contingency plan. And so it seems to be very practical. We're saying, hey, what if reality were destroyed? Well, what would be the most practical thing to do? Work on a contingency plan ahead of time so when it happens, we have the contingency plan in place so we can go dwell in some other reality. Time and space and impermanence, etc. We can dwell there. So that seems to be not whimsical at all, not fanciful, not impractical, but the height of practicality. No extravagance there at all. Okay. But reality cannot be changed. Reality can never be destroyed. That's a fact. So actually, this whole contingency plan that we're working on is utterly whimsical and totally extravagant. It's just the height of extravagance, the height of whimsy. That's all it is. It's totally impractical. So you have someone come into the world and say, hey folks, there is an answer to all this, a very practical way to use all the staging that we have made to help us remember what reality is like. So let us say you have like a band on a stage, and they're playing songs, and the staging is all, you've set it all up, and it's, you know, kind of sets the band off, as it were. But the focus is on the songs. The band is playing all these songs. Now, what if the staging you looked at, and suddenly, very gently, the staging became exquisitely beautiful? In fact, it's the most beautiful thing you've ever seen. In fact, it's flawlessly beautiful. And it's so exquisite, so utterly exquisite, and your attention becomes entirely focused on the stage. Now, let me ask you this. Are you even paying attention to the band? Well, you see there's some figures up on the stage jumping around, but not important. Your attention isn't there at all. Now, does it really matter what songs the band is playing? No, the band, whatever songs the band wants to play, it doesn't matter. Up-tempo, ballads, whatever, avant-garde, rock, reggae, doesn't matter. because the staging is so beautiful. You look at all the staging and say, oh, God, I've never seen anything so beautiful. It's flawlessly beautiful. I wouldn't change anything about it. I just let it be exactly as it is. There's no desire on my part to change it. It's so beautiful. So now the band can keep on playing. It doesn't matter. So it's just like that. What the goal of the spiritual path is to choose a different hypothetical. Choose the hypothetical of what if we didn't need hypotheticals. And this hypothetical is set up to actually use the staging that we have worked on our hypothetical of what if the reality was annihilated, how will we survive that? It uses all the staging and makes the staging seem utterly beautiful, seamlessly, flawlessly, exquisitely beautiful, so that we have no desire to change anything. And then whatever happens on that staging makes no difference at all to us. Just like a band playing, you're not even paying attention to the songs they're playing. You realize that they're playing some songs, but your attention isn't there at all. You're saying, wow, look at that stage. Look at that board. Look at that. It's perfect. Everything's perfect. That is called the vision of Christ, or the vision of the overlay. That is, whatever you want to call it, the exquisite hypothetical, the hypothetical of remembrance, you could call it that too. A lot of different terms you could use. You can make your own term up for yourself. Whatever you, whatever you like, whatever resonates with you, that's fine. That is the goal. That is ultimate practicality. Because that is using something that had no use whatsoever. How much use does futility have? How practical is futility? Ask yourself that question. How practical is futility? It's totally impractical. It is totally extravagant. It's totally whimsical, right? Futility. This hypothetical is utterly futile. Totally futile. Has no meaning. Has no purpose. Has no application whatsoever. Because reality will never be annihilated. At all. It will remain completely, flawlessly intact. Always. So this has zero use to it. So it's, besides that, there would be no way to survive annihilation. So it's both futile and completely useless, which means it's totally impractical, which means it's totally whimsical and totally extravagant. But what do you do with it? Do you just flush it down the toilet and say, ah, I don't have anything more to do with that? No, that's not practical, because we still have a continuity problem with remembering what reality is like. So what we do, being practical, we simply use it to help us remember what reality is like. Which reality is like so beautiful, we don't want to change anything in it. We don't want to change anything. We want to expand the beauty, but we don't want to change the beauty, you see. We don't want to change the way reality is. So in order to be remembered reality, we need to use all the staging in a way that reminds us of reality, which means we need to see the staging as perfectly beautiful. We don't want to change anything at all. That's how to use it. That's practical. That's non-extravagant, non-whimsical, total utilitarian, total pragmatism. You see, for instance, Jesus was a total pragmatist. All this spiritual glamour and tinsel and all that stuff, that's not it at all. The real spiritual teachers are utter pragmatists, totally pragmatic. Only focused on what is truly useful, and that is the vision of Christ, the blessed world, the overlay. That is what is truly practical and pragmatic, and the other is utterly whimsical. So you're literally choosing between what is perfectly pragmatic and useful and what is utterly whimsical, extravagant, and useless. That's what we're choosing between on the spiritual path. That is what it's all about. So if you see this, then you are part of the solution. You have become a pragmatist, and you're dropping the whimsical extravagance. And so that's what the global challenge. You can call it Clarity Ross's global challenge, or just the global challenge. 2013, the next 4 years, is become true pragmatists. That is the challenge. Become truly pragmatic. To be the best that we can be here, we have to become truly pragmatic. So I'm giving the answer to the challenge ahead of time. But the challenge is to see that. It's to see that. Because what happens in this world is we're not sure if this hypothetical scenario is useful or not. We're not really sure. We're kind of confused about it. And so in our confusion, we're too afraid to choose. And so in our fear of choosing, because we're afraid we might choose poorly, we say, hey, wait a minute, let's choose both, or neither, actually. Let's say, let's do away with both reality and hypotheticals and find something else. What is that something else? Well, that something else is utter chaos. and which I found, and I can assure you, in the finding of it, you discard it. The moment you find it, you discard it. So that's an extravagant path. It's the height of folly and whimsicalness and extravagance to throw out both reality and hypothetical and think that there's something else. So I've already done that, been there, and realized that that is not the answer. So this confusion and fear we have of choosing, the only solution is to get on the spiritual path of clarification and move toward. That's the only way. There is no other way. We keep postponing it, thinking there's some other way. We'll find some other way. No, we will not. We don't have any choice in this situation we're in. We have no choice but to make a determination. And also the issue of, well, let's just combine reality and hypothetical. How is that? Reality is totally real and hypotheticals are totally hypothetical. That's like saying we're going to combine the presence of all light with the presence of complete absence of light, which is, again, completely whimsical and extravagant, utter nonsense. So combining the two are getting rid of both of them. Both of those are not solutions. They're non-starters. They're expression of complete whimsy. So where does that leave us? It leaves us with the necessity to take up the challenge of clarification. It's a necessity here. It's a practical necessity. It's not extravagant at all. People might say I've lived an extravagant life because all I've done is spend time clarifying. Trying to say what is truly practical, what is whimsical, what is extravagant, what is truly practical, what is truly useful, what is the truth, how do we remember reality, what's going on here, all that. And that's all I've done with my life, and it seems like, oh, I wasted my life and done nothing. How extravagant. It's not the case, because I've been able to differentiate between what is extravagant and what is whimsical and what is useful, what is pragmatic. Be able to make that distinction is right use of time here. The right use of time, and that's not whimsical. So it's been the opposite of whimsy, but from the standpoint of the world, it seems that I've lived a life of total whimsy. So there is that problem in the world, where everyone in the world thinks they're really working on something very useful and very practical and very important, and it's not extravagant or whimsical at all. They really feel that way, and they're utterly mistaken about that. So no matter who comes into this world trying to tell people, hey, people, this is what it is, they won't listen. They won't listen. For the most part. So I in a previous life, I had a lot of people respect me for what I did artistically, and so I was stupid enough, naive enough to think that coming back into this world, I said, oh, no, they'll listen to me. They'll listen to me. They listened to me before. Well, they were listening to my music, which was extravagant, really, which is an exercise in extravagance, to say the least. And I thought, oh, no, they'll listen to me. They'll respect what I have to say. Not true. Not true at all. So that was my big mistake. Is thinking I had some capital here. Had no capital. People didn't listen. They said, you're nuts. You're extravagant. You're whimsical. And to some extent, the idea of trying to produce music, beautiful music, to be the answer, that is whimsical and extravagant, because what we need to see is all the staging without exception, flawlessly beautiful and exquisite. That is way more exquisite than any music, any musical composition, way, way more, immeasurably more, because the nature of reality is there's no part that is excluded. So you cannot see some of the world as beautiful and some of it is not. That's not the way. You have to see all of it. The overlay overlays all of the staging that we have imagined. All of it, without exception. Equally. It's equally beautiful everywhere. So, to the extent that I was thinking I can... But what I wanted to do, I wanted to use my music capability to get people to listen to the teachings of truth. And that doesn't work at all, because people say, oh no, we want more music. We don't want this. That other stuff's extravagant. Give us more music. Give us more music. And you get hooked into that. It's terrible. So I had to let go of that in order to find the truth, which was very scary, because you feel like, well, if I'm letting go of my only talent I have, what am I going to do? And then have to gravitate towards being a total pragmatist, which is what Jesus was and what he's calling us to, is be a total pragmatist. Now, because that is literally the truth. We need to be total pragmatists here. It's just, what is the situation actually? What is the remedy actually? All of what we're doing is simply exercising total futility, extravagant whimsicalness, that it has no application real whatsoever. No help to us, useless. It's useless. But we have a continuity problem. We can't just drop this and go back to reality because we'd feel too much of a continuity problem. At least we imagine that. And so how do we use all the staging? We choose a different hypothetical. What if we didn't need hypotheticals? Okay. And that translates into seeing the world. Okay, seeing the world as utterly blessed, meaning we don't need to change anything. Here's another point to keep in mind on this inauguration day where we're inaugurating Clarity Ross's Global Challenge 213-216 to be utter pragmatists, is that the more we try to fix things in this world, the more we try to change, the more forgetful of reality we become. It's a vicious circle, actually. Vicious circle. We have the opposite notion. We think that the more we try to heal and change and make better, the more we're remembering reality. It is not true at all. Because in reality, there's no change whatsoever. Nothing's being changed. Nothing's being fixed. Nothing's being healed. Nothing's being gotten rid of. There are no obstructions. Nothing. There's no work going on reality at all. So the more we work to change the staging, the more forgetful we become of reality. It's a catch-22. It seems like we're trapped. But the answer is to see everything just as it is, to see a vision of everything flawlessly perfect, exquisitely beautiful. The beauty of it is so incredible, we don't want to change it at all. There's no need to change anything. There's no feeling like I need to change something. And only that gives a remembrance of reality, of simply allowing everything to be exactly as it is. Now, why would we allow everything to be exactly as it is unless it was exquisitely beautiful to us, right? And the question is, what about the body? What about the body? And we can get into that. Ultimately, from a practical standpoint, the body would not feel anything at all. It wouldn't distract our attention from the beauty. In other words, it would be flawless in getting out of the way. It's still there. It's still functional. But it has no sensation, no feeling, no distraction, no capability to distract, no pain, no suffering, nothing to distract whatsoever. It's simply a communication device that works beautifully, but it doesn't distract us from the beauty in the slightest bit. And everything, all the staging that we have brought about is completely flawless. We see it as completely flawless. And more to the point, radiating our beauty. Now, how is this possible? Well, let us say again we're looking at a stage in a concert and it's all dark and you've got the stage's got some lighting on it and all this and the band is playing and we don't really pay attention to the staging much. We're listening to the band play. Now what if there suddenly or gently there was this soft light, this beautiful light, and the whole stage was bathed in an exquisitely beautiful light. And we say, oh my God, well, where did this light come from? It's so beautiful. And so it's the stage appears beautiful because of the light that it's bathed in, you see? Actually, when we're seeing everything in this world, what are we seeing? We're seeing reflected light. We're seeing it being bathed in light, sunlight. Okay, there's another light that this world can be bathed in other than sunlight. That is the key. That is the secret. It's inner light, the spiritual light, the light of the Holy Spirit. Literally bathes the entire universe in its light. That's why it's called enlightenment. You see this other light. You see the world being bathed in this light, and it's exquisite. Somehow, the Holy Spirit is able to translate the light of the sun, all this reflected light. It's able to translate that into this other light, which is completely beautiful and exquisite. And so it shows us the whole world takes on a patina of absolute exquisiteness, no matter what's happening. Death, tragedy, everything that happens here is bathed in this exquisitely beautiful light. So beautiful that all the events that are taking place don't change this light at all. And we know this light is simply for the purpose of reminding us of what reality is like, which is the only practical use all the staging has. Death, tragedy, birth, all that stuff in itself is completely useless, has no application whatsoever. So the loving, practical thing to do is give it a use, which is to reflect this, as simply reflecting this exquisite light. Let it be bathed in this exquisite light. That's enlightenment. Totally practical. So the only question is, is it useful? Is it truly useful? What is useful? Which hypothetical is truly useful? That is the only question that we have. Which hypothetical is truly useful? And our goal is to answer that question. Global Challenge 213 216, starting on this inauguration day, is to be totally pragmatic and choose what is useful. Pretty simple, isn't it? Pretty simple. And yet, I thought, hey, it's a piece of cake. No, it's not a piece of cake to convince others of this. No, you cannot really convince them. And again, who has the spiritual capital to do that? I mean, that nobody has succeeded. You have the Buddha, you have the Jesus Christ, you have Ramana Maharshi, you have Anandamayi Ma, and others, etc., etc., etc. And they came in and they saw again this vision of Christ, the exquisiteness, flawless perfection, exquisiteness everywhere. And they said, look, this is all you need to do. This is what's useful, what's pragmatic, etc. They couldn't convince hardly anyone. Jesus didn't convince anyone during his life, really. He said, you know, nobody understands what I'm really saying. They don't get it. But later on, the Holy Spirit will have to clarify for you because you don't get it. And same with Ramana Maharshi, Anandamayi Ma, Buddha, etc. It was not easy, and so who has that? No, nobody does. Nobody does. Because the world is so entrenched in its extravagance and whimsicalness in believing that this is the ultimate pragmatism. It's utterly backwards and opposite. And so only a few seem to gravitate towards awakening. It's a struggle. What most gravitate towards is not choosing. You get to this point, this plateau ground, as it were, where you say, wait, I can't quite decide which is which. What is extravagant and what is pragmatic? I'm not really sure. And then you get into this, well, let me do both. Let me accept both reality and hypotheticals as real. Or you say, let me get rid of both. Let me accept both reality and hypotheticals as unreal. Same thing, isn't it? It's the same basic thing. Which is due to combined mutual exclusives, that leads to depression. It leads to mental illness. It leads to mental agitation and suffering of all different types. Somebody over there. So, getting past all that is the challenge. Getting past depression is the challenge. The challenge, global challenge, 213, 216, is to get us past that depressive phase. Get us past that depressive phase, really. Because if we don't pick up this challenge now, there's a very real possibility and almost a likelihood that many people will get depressed in the next 4 years. Really depressed, really super depressed. That's not good. That is not good because I've been there and done that. And that's why I'm so adamant about this and putting myself out there, taking all the risks to speak up, because I know what depression is all about. I've been through it entirely, from the very lowest point possible, which is utter mental chaos, all the way through, down, the road back, everything. And it is no fun. Really no fun. You might say it's the worst situation beyond what you can imagine right now, really. And you don't want it, but you feel trapped and you don't know how to get out. You keep trying to make both reality and hypotheticals real, or both of them unreal, and it can go down because you can't. You don't know how to choose between the two, which is right and which is, you don't know how to choose. So it's super important to have spiritual mentoring, which is what got me out of it. Super important. So I'm adamantly aligned with the whole program of spiritual mentoring because it works. So we will continue on with that. And let me finish this taping up here right now, and we will go on to the next one as we fill up this inauguration day with a few boosts, big boosts, to get this whole thing going, the global challenge. All right, very great. That's it.